Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of The Fourth Part of the World, The Race to the Ends of the Earth, and the epic story of the map that gave America its name, by Toby Lester, narrated by Peter J. Fernandez and directed by Sarah Sarchin. This book opens with the following quote from Etymologies by Isidore of Seville, written circa 600 AD. The earth is placed in the central region of the cosmos, standing fast in the center, equidistant from all other parts of the sky. It is divided into three parts, one of which is called Asia, the second Europe, the third Africa. Apart from these three parts of the world, there exists a fourth part, beyond the ocean, which is unknown to us. And now, the fourth part of the world.
Prologue. Awakening. First, a quote by John Boyd Thatcher, 1896. But where is this Vault Simula map? Somewhere, in some dark corner of a monastic library, folded away in some oak-bound volume, a copy may be sleeping. It was a curious little book. When copies began resurfacing in the 18th and 19th centuries, nobody quite knew what to make of them. 103 pages long and written entirely in Latin, the book laid out its contents on its title page. Introduction to cosmography, with certain principles of geometry and astronomy necessary for this matter. Additionally, the four voyages of Amerigo Vespucci. A description of the whole world on both a globe and a flat surface with the insertion of those lands unknown to Ptolemy, discovered by recent men. Distich. Since God rules the heavens and Caesar the lands, neither the earth nor the stars have greater than these. The book, known today as the Cosmographiae Introductio, or Introduction to Cosmography, listed no author. But it did provide a few scattered clues about its origins. A printer's mark at the back of the book recorded that it had been published 7 years after the sesquimillennium, in the Vosgian Mountains, in a town named after Saint Diodatus. This was easy enough to decipher. The date of publication was 1507, and the town was Saint-Dié, a little town in eastern France, located some 60 miles to the southwest of Strasbourg, in the Vosges Mountains of Lorraine. More clues appeared in the book's two opening dedications, both of which paid tribute to a certain Maximilian Caesar Augustus. Only one figure at this time in European history carried this title, Maximilian I, a German monarch known as King of the Romans, who would soon become Europe's Holy Roman Emperor. The authors of the two dedications were less easy to identify. Although they seem to have played roles in the preparation and printing of the book, they identified themselves only as Philegius Vogesigina and Martinus Ilacomulus, pen names that had long ago been forgotten. The word cosmography isn't used much today, but educated readers in 1507 knew what it meant: the study of the known world and its place in the cosmos. At the time, as had been the case for centuries, scholars believed the cosmos to consist of a set of giant concentric spheres. The moon, the sun, and the planets each had their own sphere, and beyond them was a single sphere containing all of the stars, the firmament. The earth sat motionless at the center of these spheres, each of which wheeled grandly around the globe day and night in a never-ending procession. It was the job of the cosmographer, who was at once a geographer, an astronomer, a mathematician, and even a philosopher, to describe the visible makeup of the cosmos and to explain how its various parts fit together. The Introduction to Cosmography devoted its opening 35 pages to this task. Methodically and authoritatively, the work laid out a traditional model of the cosmos. First came the abstract definitions: a circle, a line, an angle, a solid, a sphere, an axis, a pole, a horizon. Then came descriptions of the order of the cosmos, supported with practical diagrams and quotations from ancient authorities. Finally, came the Earth itself, its place at the center of the cosmos, its shape, which everybody knew was spherical, its various climate zones, its winds, and its many habitable and uninhabitable regions. This was familiar material. Countless other textbooks and treatises had covered the very same ground. That was precisely the point. The world and the cosmos were what they had always been, and the introduction to cosmography taught its readers how to study them. But near the end of the book, in the chapter devoted to the makeup of the Earth, the author did something extremely unusual. He elbowed his way onto the page to make an oddly personal announcement. It came just after he had introduced readers to Asia, Africa, and Europe, the three parts of the world that had been known since antiquity. "These parts," he wrote, "have in fact now been more widely explored, and a fourth part has been discovered by Amerigo Vespucci, as will be heard in what follows. Since both Asia and Africa received their names from women, I do not see why anyone should rightly prevent this new part from being called Amerigen, the land of Amerigo, as it were, or America, after its discoverer, Americus, a man of perceptive character." It was a profoundly strange moment. With no fanfare, near the end of a minor Latin treatise on cosmography published in the mountains of eastern France, a nameless 16th century author had stepped briefly out of obscurity to give America its name. And then, he had disappeared again. Only the first third of the introduction to cosmography actually provided an introduction to cosmography. The rest of the work consisted of a long letter written by Amerigo Vespucci and addressed to one René II, the Duke of Lorraine. In colorful and often lurid detail, Vespucci, a Florentine merchant, described four voyages that he had made, or at least claimed to have made, to the New World between 1497 and 1504. It was the search for this letter, in fact, that had brought copies of the Introduction to Cosmography back to light in the 18th century. At issue was a question that historians of the Age of Discovery had been rancorously debating for centuries. Who had reached the mainland of the New World first, Christopher Columbus or Amerigo Vespucci? Nobody doubted that Columbus had sailed west across the Atlantic before Vespucci. As was well known, Columbus had made four voyages of western discovery, starting in 1492. But during the first two voyages, which took place between 1492 and 1496, he had only visited the islands of the Caribbean, which he called the Indies, believing them to lie on the outskirts of Asia. Not until 1498, during his third voyage, did he finally set foot on continental soil, on the coast of present-day Venezuela. This was the moment Columbus' partisans felt that represented the true European discovery of the New World. One of the first to put this view into writing, sometime before the middle of the 16th century, was the Spanish friar Bartolomé de las Casas. "It is manifest," he thundered in the first book of his General History of the Indies, "that the Admiral Don Cristobal Colón was the first by whom divine providence ordained that this, our great continent, should be discovered," adding, "No one can presume to usurp the credit, nor to give it to himself or to another, without wrong, injustice, and injury committed against the Admiral, and consequently without offense against God." What provoked this outburst was the little introduction to cosmography. Las Casas had studied the book carefully and was deeply offended by its Vespucci letter, which suggested that Vespucci had visited the coast of South America in 1497, a year before Columbus. Columbus had been the first to reach the Indies, the book suggested, but Vespucci was the one who had discovered the New World. No evidence in the historical record corroborated this claim, however, and Las Casas decided it was a wrong he had to right. writing with the introduction to cosmography explicitly in mind. He dismissed Vespucci as a fraud and set in motion a debate about the discovery of the New World that would rage internationally for centuries. It is well here to consider the injury and injustice which that Amerigo Vespuccio appears to have done to the admiral, or that those who published his four voyages have done, in attributing the discovery of this continent to himself, without mentioning anyone but himself. Owing to this, all the foreigners who write of these Indies in Latin, or in their own mother tongue, or who make charts or maps, call the continent America, as having been first discovered by Amerigo. Certainly these voyages unjustly usurp from the admiral the honor and privilege of having been the first who, by his labors, industry, and the sweat of his brow, gave to Spain and the world the knowledge of this continent. The introduction to cosmography faded quickly from memory after Las Casas' death in 1566. But the name America stuck, to the consternation of many Spaniards, who considered it an affront not only to Columbus, but also to their national honor. Others carried Las Casas' anti-Vespucci campaign forward, and by the 19th century, even Americans themselves had joined in. "Everybody knows the crafty wiles of these losel Florentines," Washington Irving wrote in 1809, "by which they filched away the laurels from the arms of the immortal Cologne, vulgarly called Columbus, and bestowed them on their officious townsman, Amerigo Vespucci." Ralph Waldo Emerson weighed in later in the century, famously reflecting on how strange it was that broad America must wear the name of a thief, who managed in this lying world to supplant Columbus and baptize half the earth with his own dishonest name. The people of Florence naturally had a different take on the matter. The Florentine astronomer Stanislao Canovai summed it up in a public eulogy he delivered for Vespucci on October 15, 1788. "The universe, astonished at his deeds, regarded him as the confidant of the stars, as the father of cosmography, as the wonder of navigation, and having by the unanimous suffrages of all nations abolished that primitive denomination, the New World, willed that the continent should derive its name from Americus alone, and with sublime gratitude and justice secured that reward to him and an eternity of fame. But will you believe it? Some countries still nourish hearts so ungrateful and minds so narrow that they have not only dishonored with satire the incomparable deeds of Vespucius, but, expostulating loudly against the unanimous decree of the nations, have made it criminal in Americus that his name has thus been adopted, and have depicted him in the black colors of an ambitious usurper." All things considered, it was an epic fuss. Quite something for an obscure little treatise on cosmography to have stirred up. The first widely read author to focus popular attention on the introduction to cosmography was Washington Irving. While working on a biography of Christopher Columbus in the 1820s, Irving decided that he should try to settle the Columbus-Vespucci debate in Columbus's favor. Combing through the scholarly literature on Vespucci in an attempt to confirm that Vespucci's 1497 voyage had never taken place, Irving discovered the work of an Italian abbot named Francesco Cancellieri, who some decades earlier had chanced across a copy of the Introduction to Cosmography in the Vatican Library and had summarized its contents, briefly but in enough detail to make it clear that Vespucci had had nothing to do with the naming of America. When he published his Columbus biography in 1828, Irving therefore set the record straight about Vespucci. "His name," he wrote, "was given to that part of the continent by others. The deed," he explained in a footnote, "had been done in Saint-Dié in Lorraine in 1507. On the question of who those others might have been, however, he had nothing to say. The person who finally worked out the answer was Baron Alexander von Humboldt, one of the great scholars and explorers of the 19th century. Intrigued by what Irving had written about the introduction to cosmography, Humboldt developed an obsession with the book, and in 1839, after much investigation, announced that he had unearthed its secret. "This extremely rare book has taken up much of my time in recent years," he wrote in his monumental critical examination of the history of the geography of the new continent, adding, "I have had the pleasure of recently discovering the name and the literary connections of the mysterious character who first proposed the name America to designate the new continent, and who hid himself under the Hellenized name Hylacomelus." The story that Humboldt had pieced together went something like this. Hylacomelus, Martinus Hylacomelus, that is, the author of one of the Introduction to Cosmography's dedications, was Martin Waldseemüller, a German cartographer from near Freiburg. Philesius Vogesigina, the author of the other dedication, was Matthias Ringmann, a young poet and classicist from a town in the Vosges Mountains. The two men were friends, and in the very early years of the 16th century, they had made their way to Saint-Dié. There they became part of a tiny group of scholars and printers who, with the patronage of Duke René, established a scholarly press and began calling it the Gymnasium Vosgiense. After the Duke received his famous Vespucci letter and shared it with the members of the Gymnasium, they decided it was time to put Vespucci's discoveries into theoretical, that is, a cosmographical, context. And so it was in 1507 that America got its name, and the Introduction to Cosmography came into being. Humboldt's reconstruction was a tour de force of literary historical detective work, meticulously researched, closely argued, and elegantly written. His announcement inspired others to seek out the Introduction to Cosmography. But now, instead of flipping directly to the Naming of America passage and the Vespucci letter, they began to read the whole work. And those who studied it carefully realized that Humboldt had sidestepped one important aspect of the book's story. The American politician and statesman Charles Sumner acquired a partial copy of the book in the middle of the 19th century, and on its front flyleaf he penned a thought that was occurring to more and more people. "Whoever he was," Sumner wrote, "the author of this cosmography has done more than give America the name it bears at present. For it may be seen in different passages of his work that already at the commencement of 1507 he had prepared maps of the world confirming all that was known of the New World." The maps. All that fuss about Vespucci and the naming of America had made readers overlook the last item that had been announced on the Introduction to Cosmography's title page, the map and the globe. Students of the book now recognized that these maps were the main reason the book had been written. The book's author himself made this point unambiguously, but only in an easy-to-miss paragraph printed on the back of a fold-out diagram. "The purpose of this little book," he declared, "is to write a sort of introduction to the whole world that we have depicted on a globe and on a flat surface." The rest of the paragraph went on to describe the map in considerable detail. "The globe, certainly, I have limited in size, but the map is larger. As farmers usually mark off and divide their farms by boundary lines, so it has been our endeavor to mark the chief countries of the world by the emblems of their rulers. And, to begin with our own continent, in the middle of Europe we have placed the eagles of the Holy Roman Empire, which rules the kings of Europe, and with the key, which is the symbol of the Holy Father, we have enclosed almost the whole of Europe, which acknowledges the Roman Church. The great part of Africa and a part of Asia we have distinguished by crescents, which are the emblems of the Supreme Sultan of Babylonia, the Lord of all Egypt, and a part of Asia. The part of Asia called Asia Minor, we have surrounded with a saffron-colored cross joined to a branding iron, which is the symbol of the Sultan of the Turks, who rules Scythia this side of the Emmaus, the highest of the mountains of Asia, and Sarmatian Scythia. Asiatic Scythia we have marked by anchors, which are the emblems of the great Tartar Khan. A red cross symbolizes Prester John, who rules both eastern and southern India, and who resides in Bibrith. And finally, on the fourth part of the world, discovered by the kings of Castile and Portugal, we have placed the emblems of those sovereigns. What is not to be ignored is that we have marked with crosses shallow places in the sea where shipwreck may be feared. With this, we end. Other information about the map appeared in Waldseemüller's dedication to Maximilian I. "To the best of my ability and with the help of others," Waldseemüller wrote, "I have studied the books of Ptolemy from a Greek copy, and having added the information from the four voyages of Amerigo Vespucci, I have prepared a map of the whole world. This work I have determined to dedicate to your most sacred majesty, since you are the lord of the world." At the end of the work itself, the author also mentioned making this map in sheets, which suggested a map of considerable size, assembled from a number of separately printed pages. The author noted that in preparing his map, he consulted not only the work of Ptolemy, an ancient Greek geographer, but also charts made by modern sailors. And immediately after the naming of America paragraph, he dropped a bombshell. "This new part of the world," he wrote, "is found to be surrounded on all sides by the ocean." This was an astonishing statement to make in 1507. According to the history books, it was only in 1513, after Vasco Núñez de Balboa had first caught sight of the Pacific by looking west from a mountain peak in Panama, that Europeans began to conceive of the New World as a separate continent. Columbus had died in 1506, believing he had reached the vicinity of Japan and China, and Vespucci himself had explicitly referred to the region he had explored as an endless Asian land. Only after 1520, once Magellan had rounded the bottom of the New World and sailed into the Pacific, were Europeans supposed to have confirmed the continental nature of the New World. So why did the introduction to cosmography announce the New World to be surrounded by water? Was this just an inspired guess, made in the same poetic spirit of invention that had summoned the name America into being? Or was it an indication that Waldseemüller and his colleagues had had access to information about a forgotten voyage of discovery that had reached the west coast of South America before 1507, a voyage that perhaps had even involved Amerigo Vespucci himself? Nobody could say. All that was certain was that this map presented a revolutionary new geographical vision. Prepared with care by a team of scholars, printed on several sheets, and showing the world's political divisions, it synthesized the learning of the ancients and the discoveries of the moderns, and brought them together to create a new picture of the world, one that expanded it dramatically to include a new continent bearing the name America. Unfortunately, however, the introduction to cosmography contained no such map. The map took on an increasingly legendary aspect as the 19th century progressed. Scholars searched for it in libraries and map collections, and published extensive new studies concerning the activities of Waldseemüller, Ringmann, and the Gymnasium Vossegense. As the 400th anniversary of Columbus's first voyage approached, the idea of finding the map became something of a quest for the cartographical Holy Grail. Ever since Humboldt first called attention to the Cosmographiae Introductio, the geographical journal declared at the turn of the century, no lost maps have ever been sought for so diligently as those of Waldseemüller. It is not too much to say that the honor of being their lucky discoverer has long been considered as the highest possible prize to be obtained amongst students in the field of ancient cartography. Yet no copy of the map turned up. And as the final decade of the century approached, some specialists began to dismiss the search for the map as a waste of time. Much of what is written about the gymnasium of Sendie and Waldseemüller, wrote the towering cartographical authority, Baron Adolf Erich Nordenschuld, in 1889, has been a useless exhibition of learning. Less than a decade later, in 1897, the Baron had to eat his words. That year, the Geographical Journal announced the discovery in Germany of several small maps drawn by hand in 1510, documents of special interest, the journal reported, as helping us in some measure to reconstruct the lost map of Waldseemüller. The maps were the work of a Swiss humanist named Henricus Glarianus. On one of his maps, Glarianus had noted that in drawing it, he had followed the Diodatian or preferably Vosgian geographer, a clear reference to Waldseemüller. On another of his maps, one of two discovered in Glarianus's own copy of the Introduction to Cosmography, Glarianus had provided even more information. The original Waldseemüller map was far too big to fit into the Introduction to Cosmography, he wrote. And so, in order to make his copy of the book complete, he had decided to make a reduced copy. "I have depicted it proportionally on a small scale," he wrote, "the three parts of the world and the recently discovered fourth American land." Oddly, the two maps found in Glarianus's copy of the Introduction to Cosmography seemed to be copies of two different maps. One showed the Western Hemisphere, and the other showed the world as a whole. This was hard to explain, given that the two maps were supposedly copies of the same original, but despite their differences, they were clearly related. Both placed the words American land, Terra America, on the southern portion of the New World that Amerigo Vespucci claimed to have visited, and both depicted it as a new continent, completely surrounded by water. It was a thrilling discovery. Scholars could now reconstruct with some certainty what the lost map had actually looked like. Waldseemüller, it seemed, had created the document of modern world cartography, the first map to present a vision of the world's continents and oceans that corresponds roughly to the one we know today. The search for the map continued in the 1890s, but it bore no fruit. Writing in 1896 in The Continent of America, Its Discovery and Its Baptism, the historian of discovery John Boyd Thatcher admirably summed up everything known about the Waldseemüller story, but when it came time for him to address the question of the missing map, he simply threw up his hands. "The mystery of the map," he wrote, "is a mystery still." In the summer of 1901, freed from his teaching duties at Stella Matutina, a Jesuit boarding school in Feldkirch, Austria, Father Joseph Fischer packed his things and set out for Germany. Balding, bespectacled, and 44 years old, Fischer was a professor of history and geography. For the previous 7 years, he had been haunting the public and private libraries of Europe in his spare time, hoping to find maps that showed evidence of the early Atlantic voyages of the Norsemen. This current trip was no exception. Earlier in the year, in correspondence with Father Hermann Hafner, a Jesuit in charge of the impressive collection of books and maps at Wolfegg Castle in southern Germany, Fischer had received word of a rare 15th-century world map that depicted Greenland in an unusual way. Fischer only had to travel some 50 miles from Stella Matutina to reach Wolfegg, a tiny town situated in the rolling countryside just north of Austria and Switzerland, not far from Lake Constance. He reached the town on July 15th, and upon his arrival at the castle, he was met by its owner, Prince Franz zu Waldburg Wolfegg und Waldsee, who Fischer would later recall immediately offered him a most friendly welcome and all the assistance that could be desired. The map of Greenland turned out to be everything Fischer had hoped it would be. As was his custom on research trips, after studying the map, Fischer began a systematic search of the prince's entire collection, in the hopes of finding other items of interest. First, he made his way through the large inventory of maps and prints, which, to Fisher's delight, did indeed contain a number of treasures. He then spent hours immersed in the castle's library, inspecting many of its rare books. And then, on July 17th, his third day at the castle, he walked over to the castle's south tower. On the second floor of the tower, he had been told, he would find a small garret containing what little he hadn't yet seen of the castle's collection. The garret is a simple room. It's designed for storage, not show. Bookshelves line three of its walls, from floor to ceiling, and two windows let in a cheery amount of sunlight. The floors, uncarpeted, are lined with broad, unfinished planks. Wandering about the room and peering at the spines of the books on the shelves, Fisher soon came across something that piqued his curiosity. A large folio with red beechwood covers, bound together with finely tooled pigskin. Two Gothic brass clasps held the folio shut, and Fisher pried them open gently. On the inside cover, he found a small bookplate bearing the date 1515 and a small inscription which gave him the name of the folio's original owner, Johannes Scherner, a well-known 16th-century German mathematician and geographer. Posterity, the inscription began. Scherner gives this to you as an offering. Fisher started leafing carefully through the folio and discovered to his amazement that it contained not only a rare 1515 star chart engraved by Albrecht Dürer, one of the most famous and sought after of all Renaissance artists, but also two giant and unfamiliar world maps. Fisher had never seen anything quite like them. In pristine condition, printed from intricately carved woodblocks, each map was made up of 12 separate sheets that, if removed from the folio and assembled, would create maps approximately 4.5 by 8 feet in size. Fisher began examining the first map in the folio. Its title, running in block letters across the bottom of the map, read, "The Whole World According to the Tradition of Ptolemy and the Voyages of Americus Vespucius and Others." This was language that immediately brought to mind the introduction to cosmography, as did what Fisher saw at the top of the map. On the folio's second page, on one of the map's top four sheets, Fisher found a finely executed portrait of Ptolemy, shown gazing east out over a small inset hemisphere that contained Europe, Africa, and Asia. The meaning of the image was clear. This was the Old World, as it had been known since ancient times, and as Ptolemy himself had mapped it. Another portrait, designed to join and complement the first, appeared on the following page. This one showed Amerigo Vespucci gazing west out over the other half of the world, which contained what we know today as North and South America, the Pacific, and the Far East. This was the New World as it had been explored and mapped in recent centuries, and it bore a startlingly close resemblance to Glarianus's map of the Western Hemisphere. Fisher's pulse quickened. Could he be looking at the map? He hardly dared think so, but the little hemisphere's rare depiction of the New World, along with the rare pairing of Ptolemy and Vespucci at the top of the map, was irresistibly suggestive. Fisher began to study the map sheet by sheet. He quickly determined that the map's two center sheets, which showed Europe, Northern Africa, the Middle East, and Western Asia, derived straight from the work of Ptolemy, whose ancient maps had been revived and reproduced widely during the 15th century. Farther to the east, beyond the limits of the world as Ptolemy had known it, the map borrowed a depiction of the Far East that Fisher had seen on other maps of the period, a highly conjectural vision of the region based largely on the writings of Marco Polo. Fisher immediately noticed, however, that the map's depiction of Southern Africa derived from a third source, sailors' charts that showed the sea route around the continent and into the Indian Ocean that the Portuguese had pioneered at the end of the 15th century. It was an unusual mix of styles and sources, and precisely the sort of synthesis that the introduction to cosmography had promised. There was more. Strewn across the map's pages was the very set of political emblems mentioned in the introduction to cosmography: the imperial eagle, the papal key, the branding iron, the anchor, and the various kinds of crosses. But Fisher got his biggest thrill when he turned to the map's three western sheets. What he saw there, rising out of the water and stretching some 3 feet from the top of the map to its bottom, was a giant depiction of the new world surrounded by water, one that bore an uncanny resemblance to the new world as it appeared on the other map found in Glarianus's introduction to cosmography. It was a breathtaking sight. A legend at the bottom of the page told readers what they were looking at, and the language corresponded verbatim to a paragraph that appeared in the introduction to cosmography. "A general description," the legend read, "of the various lands and islands, including some of which the ancients make no mention, discovered lately between 1497 and 1504 in 4 voyages over the seas, 2 by Fernando of Castile and 2 by Manuel of Portugal, most serene monarchs, with Amerigo Vespucci as one of the navigators and officers of the fleet, and especially a delineation of many places hitherto unknown." North America appeared on the top sheet, a runt version of its modern self, and at its western edge it bore the words, "Distant Unknown Land." Just to the south lay a number of Caribbean islands, among them 2 big ones identified as Española and Isabella, accompanied by a small legend that read, "These islands were discovered by Columbus, an admiral of Genoa, at the command of the King of Spain." What dominated this side of this map, however, filling 2 entire sheets, was a vast southern landmass, long and thin, that stretched from above the equator right down to the very bottom of the map. The words, "Distant Unknown Land," appeared on the northwest coast of this landmass too, and just below the equator another legend read, "This whole region was discovered by the order of the King of Castile." But what stunned Fisher was what he saw on the bottom sheet. Printed on what we know today as Brazil, and placed alongside the stretch of coastline described by Amerigo Vespucci in his letters, was a single word, "America." Flush with excitement, and now allowing himself to believe that he had indeed found the missing map, Fisher scoured it for a date or an author. But he found nothing anywhere, until he turned to the second map in the folio. Dated 1516, this map called itself a Carta Marina, Latin for marine chart. The map was gorgeous, illustrated and annotated in almost bewildering detail. But except for its size and 12-sheet format, it bore little resemblance to the first map. It made no nod to Ptolemy. It didn't show the New World as surrounded by water, and it used only the words "New Land" to identify South America, which itself was depicted far more tentatively than on the first map. But at the bottom of the map, Fisher found a note that must have made him sit up straight. "Arranged and completed by Martin Waldseemüller, Isla Comelis," it read, "in the town of Saint-Dié." Even better, he discovered the longest legend on the map to be a rambling address to the reader written by Waldseemüller himself. "A greeting from Waldseemüller," Fisher would later recall thinking. And in that address, Waldseemüller made a brief allusion to an earlier map of the world that he had designed, one that sounded a lot like the anonymous map Fisher had just been looking at. "In the past," Waldseemüller wrote, "we published an image of the whole world in 1,000 copies, which was completed in a few years, not without hard work, and based on the tradition of Ptolemy, whose works are known to few because of his excessive antiquity." Fisher no longer had any doubts. The prominent juxtaposition of Ptolemy and Vespucci, the use of the word America, the echoes of the introduction to cosmography, the resemblance to the Glarianus maps, the new world shown surrounded by water, the reliance on sailors' charts, the statements of Vault Simula himself. The evidence was overwhelming. Alone in the little garret in the tower of Volfig Castle, Father Fisher realized that he had discovered Vault Simula's long-lost 1507 map, the most sought-after map of all time. Fisher took the news of his discovery straight to his mentor and former professor, the renowned historian of cartography, Franz Ritter von Wieser, who, as it happened, was the one who had discovered the Glarianus maps in the Introduction to Cosmography. In the fall of 1901, after a period of intense study, Fisher and von Wieser went public with news of Fisher's discovery, and the reception was ecstatic. Geographical students in all parts of the world have awaited with the deepest interest details of this most important discovery, the Geographical Journal declared, breaking the news in a February 1902 essay. But no one was probably prepared for the gigantic cartographical monster which Professor Fisher has now awakened from so many centuries of peaceful slumber. The New York Times followed suit on March 2nd. Under the headline, Long-Sought Map Discovered, Earliest Known Record of the Word America Finally Brought to Light, the paper reported, there has lately been made in Europe one of the most remarkable discoveries in the history of cartography, and one which must hereafter be referred to in all works pretending to give in detailed form the story of the New World. More acclaim came the following year, when Fisher and von Wieser published the oldest map with the name America and the Carta Marina of the year 1516. The book was a critical study of the Vault Simula map of 1507 and the Carta Marina, but it also announced a new Vault Simula discovery. In researching the book, Fisher and von Wieser wrote they had managed to identify a tiny little printed world map, discovered in the late 19th century and initially believed to date from well after 1507, as an original copy of the globe mentioned on the title page of the Introduction to Cosmography. The map consisted of a set of interconnected oval strips, known as gores, that were designed to be cut out and pasted onto a ball, and it too identified the New World as America and showed it as surrounded by water. Here was yet another Vault Simula first, history's first mass-produced globe. The oldest map brought together the big Vault Simula map, little globe, and the Introduction to Cosmography for the first time in centuries. It was a large and luxurious book designed to attract attention, and it got it. President Theodore Roosevelt acquired a copy not long after the book was published, and was so pleased with it that he sent Fisher a handwritten note congratulating him on his discoveries. The book also found its way to Pope Pius X. During a private meeting with Fisher at the Vatican, the Pope confessed that he had been gratified to learn that the New World had been first named and put on the map by Vault Simula, a Catholic cleric who had lived and worked before the so-called Reformation. Interest in the map continued to build, climaxing in 1907, when the London-based bookseller Henry Newton Stevens Jr., a leading dealer in Americana, secured the rights to put the 1507 map and the Carta Marina up for sale for $300,000, almost $8 million in today's currency. Stevens knew that his asking price put the maps beyond the reach of private collectors, so in his auction catalog, after calling attention to the fact that 1907 was the 400th anniversary of the naming of America, he aimed his sales pitch elsewhere. What more suitable or patriotic commemoration of that auspicious event could possibly be conceived than the securing of this unique contemporary memento for some representative American library, where it could be seen and studied by geographical students, admired by all lovers of art, and reverenced for all time by historians and antiquarians as the veritable fountainhead from whence, in conjunction with the book Cosmographiae Introductio, America received its baptismal appellation. Stevens talked a good game, but he found no takers. His asking price was too high. The 400th anniversary passed, two world wars and the Cold War engulfed Europe for much of the 20th century, and the Vault Simula map, left alone in its tower garret, went to sleep once more. But today, at last, the map is awake again, this time for good. On April 30th, 2007, almost exactly 500 years after its making, the map was officially transferred to the United States by Germany's Chancellor Angela Merkel. In December of the same year, the map was put on permanent public display at the Library of Congress, encased in the most sophisticated and expensive picture frame ever made, as the centerpiece of a permanent exhibit titled Exploring the Early Americas. It's a small exhibit. As you move through it, you pass a variety of priceless cultural artifacts made in the pre-Columbian Americas, along with a choice selection of original texts and maps dating from the period of first contact between the New World and the Old. Finally, you arrive at an inner sanctum. There, reunited with the Carter Marina, the Scherner Folio, and the Introduction to Cosmography, is the Vault Simula map itself. The room is quiet, the lighting dim. To see the map, you have to move close and peer at it carefully. And when you do, it begins to tell its stories. Part 1. Old World. Chapter 1. Matthew's Maps. We begin with a quote from St. Bernard of Clairvaux, circa 1150. It is the vocation of a monk to seek not the earthly but the heavenly Jerusalem, and he will do this not by setting out on his feet, but by progressing with his feelings. In the early 1200s, the Benedictine monastery of St. Albans hummed with activity. Situated just a day's ride north of London, the monastery was one of the largest and most important in England, home to as many as 200 monks. In the parlance of the times, they were Latins, members of the greater community of Roman Catholics in Europe who submitted to the authority of the Pope. But St. Albans wasn't just a religious retreat. It was a busy center of economic, political, and intellectual life, and even had served as the site of an early drafting of the Magna Carta in 1213. It also ran a popular guest house, the first stopping point on the Roman-built Great North Road out of London, and operated stables that could accommodate some 300 horses at a time. By the beginning of the 13th century, St. Albans was feeding and lodging a steady stream of visitors on their way to and from London. Oxford professors, royal counselors, powerful bishops, papal emissaries and monks from elsewhere in Europe, a traveling delegation of Armenians, and even the King of England himself. It was a worldly place. After a day of traveling, guests would unwind in the monastery's dormitories and refectory. Inevitably, the talk would turn to where they had come from and to what news and information they had picked up along the way. Again and again, the same subjects came up: the weather, local crimes and misdemeanors, politics, the antics of the royals, the utterances of the Pope, and the ill-conceived and apparently interminable series of wars being waged in the Middle East, the Crusades. One monk in particular had a special interest in stories from beyond the monastery's walls. A down-to-earth, willfully opinionated, and generally likable crank, he was Brother Matthew Paris, the greatest and most colorful of all medieval church chroniclers. Born in about 1200, Matthew joined the Benedictine order at St. Albans in 1217, became its official chronicler in 1237, and died in 1259.
The work for which Matthew is most famous is the Chronica Majora, or Great Chronicle, a vast history of the world that in typical medieval fashion extends from the time of the creation right up to Matthew's own time. The first half or so of the Chronicle amounts to little more than Matthew's copying and fiddling with the Chronicle of his predecessor. But from 1235 forward, the entries are his own. And in one commonly consulted English translation, they fill 3 500-page volumes. Yet, despite its size, the Chronicle is a wonderfully good read. Matthew wrote and wrote and wrote. Keeping him properly supplied with writing materials alone was a tall order. In the 13th century, the production of a book, that is, a manuscript scratched out with goose quill and ink, on page after page of parchment, amounted to a significant investment of a monastery's capital. A single book might well consume the skins from a whole flock of sheep. But Matthew's output justified this investment. It brought St. Albans great renown, even during Matthew's own lifetime. Matthew was more than just a writer. He was also a gifted artist who illustrated his work with everything from tiny doodlings to lavishly executed portraits. Biblical figures, ancient emperors, popes, European kings, saints, monks, martyrs, battles, shipwrecks, eclipses, exotic animals, they all come to life on Matthew's pages, and not just as frivolous additions to his text. They were an integral part of his chronicle. "I desire and wish," he wrote, "that what the ear hears, the eyes may see." That brief reference to hearing, rather than reading, serves as a useful reminder. In 13th century England, reading was primarily an oral act, not a silent one. Monks in monastery libraries read aloud to themselves, and the din they created would have exasperated modern library patrons. Matthew read to himself, to his fellow monks, and to special guests visiting the monastery, and what he offered his readers and listeners was a captivating mix of words and pictures. Turning the pages of Matthew's Chronica Majora, one modern historian has written, is like opening the door of a great abbey cupboard, from which spills forth a rich succession of disparate images and objects, each conjuring up its own compelling story from the past, so that each event again becomes visually present. The Great Abbey Cupboard. That's a critical image to keep in mind when trying to make sense of the jumble of disparate ideas and images that one encounters in the works of Matthew and other medieval writers, especially in their maps. Matthew had a passion for maps. He drew them throughout his adult life, following a number of traditional models, and those that survive provide a remarkably useful survey of the different ways in which educated medieval Europeans imagined and depicted the world. One of the main sources from which Matthew received his geographical ideas was the hugely popular and influential Etymologies by Saint Isidore of Seville, a vast compendium of ancient and medieval learning, written in the 7th century AD. Throughout the Middle Ages and even into the Renaissance, Europeans considered Isidore one of their most trusted authorities. He began the geographical section of his Etymologies by situating his readers cosmically. "The earth," he wrote, "is placed in the central region of the cosmos, standing fast in the center, equidistant from all other parts of the sky." This age-old conception of the world, as a sphere that sat motionless at the center of the universe, with the moon, the sun, the planets, and the stars all revolving around it, was one that medieval authors often diagrammed in their works, and Matthew was no exception. Medieval Europeans, even the most learned of geographers among them, are to this day often described as having believed that the world was flat. But this simply isn't true. Thanks in large part to the labors of Arab astronomers and mathematicians, ancient Greek proofs of the Earth as spherical had survived into the Middle Ages and were circulating in Europe. And at some point early in the 13th century, an English scholar known as John of Hollywood, or Sacrobosco, laid them out in an astronomical treatise appropriately titled The Sphere. For centuries afterward, the work would be taught and studied in schools and universities around Europe. If the Earth were flat from east to west, Sacrobosco wrote, the stars would rise as soon for Westerners as for Orientals, which is false. Also, if the Earth were flat from north to south and vice versa, the stars that were always visible to anyone would continue to be so wherever he went, which is false. But it seems flat to human sight because it is so extensive. Sailors certainly knew the world was round. A lookout at the top of a ship's mast, Sacrobosco pointed out, always catches a sight of land before a lookout standing at the foot of the mast. And there is no other explanation of this thing, Sacrobosco wrote, than the bulge of the water. Copies of The Sphere almost invariably included a small drawing illustrating this concept. Another source that would have helped determine Matthew's geographical outlook, and one that he had access to in the library at St. Albans, was the Commentary on the Dream of Scipio by the 5th century Roman writer Macrobius. The work, which for a full millennium after it was written would be used widely as a textbook in Europe, parsed the dream of Scipio, a phantasmagoric musing on the world and its place in the cosmos, written some 5 centuries earlier by the Roman political philosopher Cicero. From a vantage point high up in the heavens, a character in Cicero's work had described the Earth just as Isidore would later do, fixed at the center of the universe, but had also drifted in for a closer look. You will observe, he declared, imagining the world as it would look from space, that the surface of the Earth is girdled and encompassed by a number of different zones, and that the two which are most widely separated from each other and lie beneath opposite poles of the heavens are rigid with icy cold, while the central broadest zone is burnt up with the heat of the sun. Two others, situated between the hot zones and the cold, are habitable. The zone which lies toward the south has no connection with yours at all. As to its northern counterpart, where you yourselves live, the territory is nothing more than a small island, narrow from north to south, somewhat less narrow from east to west, and surrounded by the sea that is known on Earth as the Atlantic or the Great Sea. Or the ocean. Macrobius elaborated at considerable length on this division of the world in his commentary, which contained a simple diagram. Today, known as a zonal map, it showed the world as a circle, divided up into the 5 zones described by Cicero. 2 frigid zones in the north and south, 2 temperate or habitable zones closer to the center, and a torrid zone that wrapped around the Earth's equatorial regions. Zonal maps were drawn and studied often during the Middle Ages, and Matthew, of course, produced his own version. As Matthew's zonal map clearly shows, the northern temperate zone, which, following the practice of Arab geographers, Matthew placed at the bottom of his map, contains the whole of the world as the ancients had described it, and as medieval Europeans still knew it. Isidore of Seville succinctly described its makeup in his Etymologies. It is divided into 3 parts, he wrote, one of which is called Asia, the second Europe, the third Africa. To accompany this description, Isidore, or one of his early copyists, drew a rudimentary diagram, and for centuries after his death, permutations of this diagram, known today as a T&O map, would adorn European encyclopedias, chronicles, religious texts, and travelogues. Matthew knew T&O maps well and drew a number of them in his work. The standard T&O map places the world within a circular frame, hence the O. That frame represents the ocean as Cicero had described it, an all-encompassing body of water that washed every shore of the known world. Asia, the biggest continent, occupies the top half of the circle. Europe and Africa share the bottom. Dividing the three continents are two lines that meet at a right angle in the middle of the map, hence the T. These represent three bodies of water: the Mediterranean, separating Europe from Africa, the River Nile, believed to separate Africa from Asia, and the River Don in Russia, separating Europe from Asia. As a whole, the T&O scheme concisely and effectively represents the world as medieval Europeans knew it. But at a certain level, the scheme is disconcerting to the modern eye, because it puts east at the top of the map. Today, north would be the natural choice, but that's an arbitrary convention, and in Matthew's time it had yet to come into being.
East, in fact, had primacy of place in medieval Europe,
which is why so many modern European languages still use a form of the word orient to describe getting one's bearings. As the direction from which the sun rose, east represented the origin of things. Oriens, the Latin root of orient, means rising. The Old Testament is built on this foundation. God planted the earthly paradise and its four great rivers eastward in Eden, the book of Genesis explains, and those waters nourished the world by flowing from east to west. The glory of the God of Israel, reads the book of Ezekiel, came from the way of the east. The New Testament develops this theme. A star in the east announces the birth of Christ, who later dies on the cross facing west. Occidens, the Latin root of occident, means falling or dying, and can refer to the setting sun. The symbolic meanings of east and west in early Christian theology were set out clearly by the 4th century church father Lactantius. God, he wrote, established two parts of the earth itself, opposite to one another and of a different character, namely the east and the west. And of these, the east is assigned to God, because he himself is the fountain of light and the enlightener of all things, and because he himself makes us rise to eternal life. But the west is ascribed to that disturbed and depraved mind, because it conceals the light, because it always brings on darkness, and because it makes men die and perish in their sins. The earliest surviving T&O maps, which appear in 8th century copies of Isidore's Etymologies, aren't invested with any such Christian symbolism. They're simple diagrams that seem based on a model that dates back at least to Imperial Roman times, although no examples survive. They were a way of signifying the extent of not just the known world, but also the world that the Romans aspired to rule. A world that the first Roman emperor, Augustus, described as a global empire to which all peoples, monarchs, nations, consent. After Christianity became the official religion of Rome in the 4th century, the idea of Christendom came into being, a global Christian empire with Rome as its capital. In the centuries that followed, Christian mapmakers in Europe invested their simple T&O maps with increasingly complex layers of symbolism. Europe's Christian rulers, for example, began to be depicted sitting on thrones and holding T&O globes in their hands, an imperial pose that would fast become a Christian archetype, used for centuries to represent not only political rulers, but also Christ himself. Matthew drew many different rulers, both ancient and modern, in this pose. The very shape of the T&O map lent itself naturally to a specifically Christian kind of symbolism. The O called to mind a biblical description of God sitting enthroned above the circle of the earth, and the T called to mind the Tau, a mystical Greek letter that, according to Isidore, symbolized the cross. Inevitably, given these overtones, Christian mapmakers began to see the T in their T&O maps as representing not just the bodies of water that divided the three continents, but also the cross that Christ had died on to bring them together. The symbolism was irresistible. What better way to convey the idea of the Trinity, a self-contained whole divided into three, than with a T&O map? Most appropriate is this division of the earth into three parts, wrote the 9th century Archbishop of Mainz, whose work Matthew also had access to at St. Albans. For it has been endowed with faith in the Holy Trinity and instructed by the Gospels. The topography of the world also began to take on a distinctly Christian aspect on medieval world maps. Paradise is a place lying in the eastern parts, Isidore told his readers. By Matthew's time, most European geographical authorities gave the earthly paradise an actual location in the world. If it was earthly, after all, it had to be somewhere. Generally, they placed it at the easternmost limits of the east, at the very edge of their maps, the parts of the world where the sun rose and where time had begun. Jerusalem, for its part, gradually became not only the spiritual but geometrical center of the world, as dictated by the Bible. This is Jerusalem, God declares in the book of Ezekiel, which I have set in the center of the nations, with countries all around her. The city even became identified with the Greek word omphalos, or navel. The geographical point on the earth where the gods made contact with the world to provide humankind with spiritual nourishment. This idea entered mainstream Christian thought in the 5th century, when an influential Latin translation of the Bible, known as the Vulgate, described the center of the world in the book of Ezekiel as the umbilicus terrae, the navel of the earth. Medieval geographers also began to fill out their TNO maps with topographical and historical information. And by Matthew's time, an elaborate and highly stylized kind of world map had come into being. These maps are often described collectively as mappi mundi, Latin for maps of the world, and needless to say, one survives in Matthew's hand. Following the TNO model, Matthew placed east at the top of his map. The west coast of continental Europe appears at the bottom left of the map, and above it, as one looks from west to east, are Germany, Alemania, the Alps, and then a thick, stubby Italy. To the east and south, up and to the right of Italy, are Cyprus and Sicily in the Mediterranean. Across the Mediterranean to the south is Africa, and to the east is Asia, on the west coast of which, occupying a lonely perch at the edge of the unknown east, is Jerusalem. Occupying the whole top portion of the map is Asia, which Matthew considered enough of a blank to fill in with notes to himself. In terms of geographical accuracy, Matthew's map is a dud. It doesn't get even the basic contours of Europe right. It places legendary, biblical, and modern places side by side, and it doesn't try to come to terms with Africa and Asia. But geographical accuracy wasn't Matthew's goal in drawing this map, at least not as we now understand the term. Remember that Matthew drew so that what the ear hears, the eyes may see. His maps were no exception. Like many religious writers of his time, he fully recognized the power of the image as a complement to the word. No, John of Genoa wrote in a popular 13th-century religious dictionary known as the Catholicon, that there were three reasons for the institution of images in churches. First, for the instruction of simple people, because they are instructed by them as if by books. Second, so that the mystery of the Incarnation and the examples of the saints may be the more active in our memory through being presented daily to our eyes. Third, to excite feelings of devotion, these being aroused more effectively by things seen than by things heard. This description suits the function of the mappi mundi well. They too were designed for spiritual instruction and contemplation. They were devotional objects, guides to the divine cosmic order of things. Their picture of the world served as a backdrop onto which the various historical, religious, and symbolic coordinates of human history could be plotted. Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, Noah and the Ark on Mount Ararat, the Jews being dragged off to Babylon, Alexander the Great venturing into India, the Romans conquering Europe,
Christ returning to Jerusalem, the apostles spreading the gospel to the most distant reaches of the earth, and much more. An accurate world map, in other words, had to orient its viewers not only in space, but also in time. Today the word mappi mundi is used exclusively to refer to maps. But Matthew and his contemporaries used it more broadly. It could mean not only a visual depiction of the world, but also a written description of it. A text very much like Matthew's chronicle, that is. It traced the march of human history, scripted in advance by God at the beginning of time, from its origins in the East to its present state in the West. A map was a visual history. A history was a textual map, and each, like that great abbey cupboard, was stuffed full of disparate signs and symbols that, contemplated together, allowed believers to imagine seeing their places in history and the world as God could see them. One of the notes that Matthew wrote on Asia on his world map records that the map was actually just a reduced copy of a mappi mundi that he had seen elsewhere. He didn't say what map this was, but without a doubt it resembled some of the gorgeous 13th century Christian mappi mundi that do survive. Among them is the so-called Psalter map, drawn in England in 1265. The Psalter map has it all. It merges the image of an imperial Christ with many of the typical elements of medieval cartography. Christ hovers above the earth holding a T and O globe in his hand, and below him is the three-part world in full, itself laid out according to the T and O scheme. At the top of the map, at the eastern limits of Asia, is the earthly paradise, just below the rising sun, with the faces of Adam and Eve clearly visible inside its walls. Europe appears at the bottom left of the map, at the world's western edge, and at the center of everything is the holy city of Jerusalem, a bullseye target for Christians to set their sights on. Another mappi mundi of the period, known as the Lambeth Palace map, depicts that very same vision of the world, but takes its symbolism one step further. Here Christ not only surveys and embraces the world, but also literally embodies it. His head appears at the top of the map, at the beginning of the east, alongside the earthly paradise. His hands appear at the north and south, representing an embrace of the whole world from north to south. Almost at the center of the map, where Christ's navel would be, is Jerusalem. The omphalos, the navel of the world. Finally, at the bottom of the map, in the west, are his feet, extending out into the ocean in the west and representing the end of both history and geography. The Psalter map contains other features typical of the elaborate mappi mundi produced in Matthew's time. At its southern edge, for example, at the limits of Africa, are the monstrous races. Part human and part beast, the monstrous races had been famously catalogued in the first century by the Roman authority Pliny the Elder, in a vast and comprehensive work called The Natural History. This catalog had been embellished and popularized some two centuries later by another Roman writer, Julius Solinus, in his Gallery of Wonderful Things. Both works circulated widely in the Middle Ages and greatly influenced the way in which Europeans imagined the distant parts of the world and their inhabitants. Medieval artists often drew the monstrous races, and their fanciful depictions are enthralling to contemplate. As described by Pliny, Solinus, and others, the monstrous races included the Amazons, warrior women who cut off their right breast in order better to pull back the arrows in their bows, the Anthropophagi, cannibals, the Aestomai, mouthless beings who derived most of their sustenance from sniffing apples, the Blemmii, beings with no head or neck, whose faces were in their chests. The Cyclopes, the one-eyed race made famous by Homer. The Cynocephali, dog-headed beings who communicated by barking. The Ethiopians, whose faces had been burned black by the heat of the sun. The Panoti,
whose ears were so large their owners had to hold them in their hands and could use them to fly, and the cyapods, a one-legged race with feet large enough to be used as umbrellas. Reading about the monstrous races and seeing them in illustrations and on maps, medieval readers were able to enjoy a form of lowbrow entertainment not unlike the one provided by modern tabloid accounts of various human monstrosities. But for Christian thinkers, they posed a serious theological concern. What was their nature? Should they be considered human? This wasn't an idle question. If the monsters were human, then they would have to be sought out and converted before the end of days could come to pass. This gospel of the kingdom, the gospel of Matthew proclaimed, shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come. The Psalter map also contains another typical feature of late medieval mappi mundi. At the northeast limits of Asia, behind a great wall, is the realm of Gog and Magog, a race of diabolical warriors sometimes identified with one of the original tribes of the Jews. According to the Book of Revelation, the forces of Gog and Magog would at some point be united by the Antichrist and led on an apocalyptic rampage against the world's Christians. Popular medieval legend had it that during his great Eastern campaign, Alexander the Great had encountered Gog and Magog and trapped them behind a distant mountain range to the north of the Caspian Sea, a story recounted, for example, in the widely read medieval Romance of Alexander. But everybody knew that Alexander's efforts had only forestalled the inevitable. Sooner or later, Gog and Magog, or the enclosed Jews as they were sometimes known, would burst out of captivity and begin to wreak havoc on the world. The idea of the apocalypse haunted Matthew, who believed, as many of his contemporaries did, that the arrival of the Antichrist and the end of the world were imminent. The mappi mundi told him this was so, in words and in pictures. From its starting point in the east, at the top of the map and at the beginning of time, human history had marched steadily westward, through the barbaric wilds of Asia, through the ever more civilized regions of Greece and Rome, through the Holy Land, and finally into Europe. All signs now suggested to Matthew that this long march was approaching its end, as the 12th century chronicler Bishop Otto of Freising had declared not long before Matthew was born. What great learning there was in Egypt and among the Chaldeans from whom Abraham derived his knowledge! But what now is Babylon, once famous for its science and its power? And Egypt is now in large part a trackless waste, whence science was transferred to the Greeks, then to the Romans, and finally to the Gauls and Spaniards. And let it be observed that because all human learning began in the Orient and will end in the Occident, the mutability and disappearance of all things is demonstrated. At St. Albans, perched precariously at the very western edge of the world in England, Matthew felt history and geography bearing down on him. The world would end in 1250, he decided, and he might well live to see the arrival of Gog and Magog. As it was for most Latin Christians, Jerusalem was the focal point of Matthew's geographical imagination. But during the years that Matthew was writing his chronicle and making his maps, Jerusalem and most of the Holy Land were in Muslim hands, despite more than a century's worth of crusading efforts to win them back. The First Crusade had been a success. Launched in 1095, it was the Latin West's response to a call for help sent by the Christians of the Byzantine Empire, who found themselves under threat from the Muslim armies of the Seljuk Turks. Earlier in the century, the Turks had conquered Armenia and much of the Holy Land, including Jerusalem, and now seemed poised to move on Constantinople, Byzantium's capital. For a time, the First Crusade, which culminated in the capture of Jerusalem in 1099, helped stem the tide, and the mood among the Latins was triumphant. They established a series of outposts across the Holy Land and named this new crusader state Outremer, a French name meaning beyond the Mediterranean Sea. Christians had long been making pilgrimages to Jerusalem, but now soldiers and pilgrims and travelers began to flock there in unprecedented numbers. The 12th century British chronicler William of Malmesbury memorably captured the scene. "The Welshman left his hunting," he wrote, "the Scot his fellowship with lice, the Dane his drinking party, and Norwegian his warship. Lands were deserted of their husbandsmen, houses of their inhabitants, even whole cities migrated." These were heady times. But the Crusader presence in the Holy Land provoked Muslims throughout the Middle East to set aside many of their regional differences and fight back. Gradually, as the 12th century progressed, Muslim armies won back many of the Holy Land's strategically important cities, and in 1187, the armies of Egypt, led by Saladin, retook Jerusalem. For the Latins, it was a humiliating defeat. In the centuries that followed, dreaming of once again taking possession of Jerusalem, they would send crusade after crusade to the Holy Land. But they would never regain control of the city. Recognizing that Christian pilgrims were Jerusalem's greatest source of income, Saladin and many of his successors allowed them to visit the city freely. As a result, by Matthew's time, several standard pilgrimage routes from Egypt to Jerusalem had come into being, and mapmakers had begun to include them on their maps, singling out important stopping points along the way. Matthew himself drew a set of such maps and included them in his chronicle. They're a valuable record of how medieval pilgrims made their way from Europe to the Holy Land, but they're also frustrating documents because of how much they leave out. Matthew drew his maps as a series of destination cities for pilgrims, often separated by the French word journée, meaning day, as in a day's travel, a usage that gave rise to the English word journey. But they reveal virtually nothing about what sort of places travelers would encounter in between those cities. They make no effort to depict Europe as a whole in a realistic way. Why not? Because once again, Matthew didn't have geographical accuracy in mind. He drew his itinerary maps primarily as contemplative guides for his fellow monks, ranks of the faithful often barred by their orders from making actual voyages to the Holy Land. "Going to Jerusalem," one monastic authority declared in the 12th century, "is indicated for laymen, but interdicted for monks." This seems an odd prescription. Monks were devoted Christians, so why prevent them from making a pilgrimage to Jerusalem? There was no shortage of reasons. A monastery itself was considered a religious endpoint, a garden of spiritual delights, lovingly tended by those who had renounced the physical world. "This is an image of paradise," one monk wrote in the 12th century about the nature and function of a monastery. "It makes one think already of heaven." Setting off on a long and arduous journey in search of what one already had at home just didn't make sense. Another problem was travel, which posed significant practical dangers. The world outside the cloister was a hazardous and ugly place. "Lord," one monk from Canterbury wrote in 1188 after making a passage across the Alps to Rome, "restore me to my brethren, that I may tell them that they come not to this place of torment." Worse yet, traveling the route to Jerusalem would force monks to run through an extended gauntlet of earthly vices, drink, desire, doubt, that could tempt them away from their chosen path. They'd already left all of that behind on their way to the monastery, so why suffer through it again? Even Jerusalem itself was best avoided. "It was a city," St. Anselm wrote, "not of peace, but of tribulation." Matthew drew his itinerary maps for mental travelers, not actual ones. They provided monks with a stop-by-stop guide for a meditative voyage, from an earthly reality in Europe to a spiritual summit in Jerusalem. "Who will give us wings like the dove?" an anonymous Benedictine monk wrote in the 12th century,
and we shall fly across all the kingdoms of the world, and we shall penetrate the depths of the eastern sky. Who will then conduct us to the city of the great king?" Matthew's maps represented an effort to answer this call. They portrayed the world as God had created it, as God alone could see it when he surveyed it from above or held it in his hand. Human history had made the long march from east to west, and God willing, a crusade would once again win back Jerusalem. The course of events, as Matthew had laid it out on his maps and in his chronicle, seemed clear. Then came the Mongols. Chapter 2. Scourge of God. We begin with a quote from Matthew Paris in the year 1240. "In this year, that human joys might not long continue, and that the delights of this world might not last long unmixed with lamentation, an immense horde of that detestable race of Satan, the Tartars, burst forth from their mountain-bound regions. Overrunning the country, covering the face of the earth like locusts, they ravaged the eastern countries." Matthew first reported that something was wrong in 1238. Merchants from northern Europe customarily sailed each year to Yarmouth, a fishing port on England's east coast, to buy herring. But in 1238, Matthew noted the merchants never came, and rotting fish piled up in the port's markets. That same year, ambassadors representing the Assassins, a widely feared Muslim sect based in Iran and Syria, arrived in England and France and appealed for help, Matthew wrote, on behalf of the whole of the people of the East. It was an extraordinary overture, given the relationship between Christians and Muslims at the time. But it was born of extraordinary circumstances. A monstrous and inhuman race of men had burst forth from the northern mountains, the ambassadors announced, and had taken possession of the extensive, rich lands of the East. The invaders were called Tartars, and they came, Matthew reported, from the Caspian Mountains or the adjacent places, the northeastern limits of the world as it was portrayed by the Mappi Mundi. Led by a most ferocious man named Khan, the Tartars had overrun vast stretches of Muslim territory and had already ravaged Greater Hungary, lands on the southwestern side of the Ural Mountains, that is, in present-day Russia. If Christians and Muslims didn't immediately put aside their differences and work together to repel the marauders in Muslim territory, the ambassadors claimed, all of Europe itself would soon be under attack. Among those at the English court who heard the assassin's appeal was the Bishop of Winchester. By Matthew's account, the bishop reacted with contempt. "Let us leave these dogs to devour one another," he scoffed, "that they may all be consumed and perish, and we, when we proceed against the enemies of Christ who remain, will slay them and cleanse the face of the earth, so that all the world will be subject to the one Catholic Church, and there will be one shepherd and one fold." But Matthew wasn't so dismissive. "Where have such people who are so numerous till now been concealed?" he wrote. "Who were these Tartars?" Grappling with such questions, Matthew and others looked to the Bible and the Mappi Mundi for help. What they found there soon made apocalyptic alarm bells begin to sound in their heads. A race of diabolical warriors from a mountainous region far off in the northeast, bent on the devastation of the Christian West? This sounded a lot like Gog and Magog. Matthew devoted long entries in his chronicle to the Tartars. Much of what he wrote derived from a report by a Hungarian friar named Julian, one of the first Europeans to describe the invaders in any detail. During the mid-1230s, Julian had left his homeland and traveled east in search of converts to Christianity, and in 1237 he had located a community of pagan ethnic Hungarians living near the Ural Mountains. To his delight,
He had discovered that they spoke his language. But they had reported alarming news. An ominous force of Tartars, fearsome horsemen and archers, Julian would later write, with heads so great that they did not seem to fit their bodies, had amassed some 15 days to the east, and they intended to devastate all the lands which they could subjugate. Although Julian didn't know it, the invaders called themselves Mongols, and they were preparing to move into Western Europe. Julian's informants almost certainly described the Mongols to him not as Tartars, but as Tatars, the name of one of the many tribes who formed part of the greater Mongol Empire. But many educated Europeans quickly associated the name with Tartarus, a Latin name for the underworld, and soon began using the name Tartars widely, a fitting description for a race of warriors apparently unleashed from hell. The Mongols originally were a tribe from the region of Lake Baikal, to the north of Mongolia in modern-day Russia. But by the time Julian heard about them, they had become a multi-ethnic federation of nomadic tribes, ruled from the high Mongolian plateau, a region of bitterly cold winters, searingly hot summers, and vast open expanses of desolate terrain. The tribes had been united at the end of the 12th century by a leader originally known as Temujin, who in 1206 was declared their undisputed leader. Temujin then proceeded to launch an astonishing series of military campaigns that, by the time of his death in 1227, put him in control of the largest contiguous land-based empire in history, one that extended from China in the east to the Caspian Sea in the west, and from Siberia in the north to northwest India in the south. Temujin and the Mongols considered their campaigns of conquest to have been ordained by the supreme sky god, Tengri, and the whole world, they believed, was a Mongol empire in the making. "Through the power of God," Great Khan Guyuk would announce to the west in 1246, "all empires from sunrise to sunset have been given to us, and we own them." Those who refused to submit to Mongol rule were rebels against the divine plan, and punishment for this refusal was often the outright slaughter of whole cities and peoples. The conquests led by Temujin were legendary, and to celebrate them, the Mongols posthumously bestowed on him the title Fierce Ruler, or Chinggis Khan. Today, thanks to an imperfect Arabic transliteration of that name, he is widely known as Genghis Khan. Genghis Khan recognized that his people, resilient horsemen accustomed to lives of hardship, deprivation, and perpetual motion, were natural warriors. They traveled with huge numbers of spare horses, and by using them in rotation, managed to travel up to 100 miles a day, a distance far greater than any other army of the time could travel. As nomads, they knew how to live off the land and the peoples they conquered, but during times of privation and hard travel, they could sustain themselves by drinking the blood of their own horses, and, if necessary, by eating them. Such practices, coupled with the ferocity of the Mongols displayed in battle, fed rumors in Europe of the Mongols as cannibals and savages. "The men are inhuman and of the nature of beasts," Matthew Paris reported, "rather to be called monsters than men, thirsting after and drinking blood and tearing and devouring the flesh of dogs and human beings." The Mongols' savagery was calculated. They wanted their reputation to precede them. Often, on the eve of an invasion, they would send advance word of their mission of conquest to their adversaries and would demand submission without a fight. Inevitably, many opponents would acquiesce, having already heard terrifying rumors about what would happen to them if they did not. And as a result, when the promised invasion actually did take place, the Mongols' ranks would already be swollen with captives. Some would be forced to fight as foot soldiers on the front ranks. Others would be enlisted as guides, interpreters, engineers, and spies. Most Europeans hadn't heard of the Mongols before Julian encountered them, but the Mongols had ventured into Eastern Europe before. In 1223, near the end of a raid that had swept around the southern end of the Caspian Sea and into the Caucasus, one of Genghis Khan's field armies had made a reconnaissance mission into what today is southern Russia. This was a standard practice. The Mongols regularly explored areas beyond their control to gather information about areas of weakness they might exploit in later campaigns. Their incursion into Russia took the locals completely by surprise. "Unknown tribes came," one Russian chronicler wrote. "None knows who they are or whence they came, nor what their language is."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.